Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2021. The first item on our agenda today is a decision on taking business in private. Can I ask whether members are content to allow agenda item 6 in private? We are content. Thank you. And the second item on the agenda is to take evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, John Swinney, MSP, and his officials on the redress for survivors, historical child abuse in care, payments materially affected by error, Scotland Regulations 2021. First of all, a very warm welcome to the Deputy First Minister to committee this morning. And Mr. Swinney is accompanied by Lisa McCloy, Divisional Development and Legislation Unit Head for the Scottish Government, and Claire Montgomery, Solicitor, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. So good morning to all. Mr. Swinney, can I invite you first to speak to the draft instrument?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting me to speak in support of the affirmative instrument before the committee. Section 97 of the Redress for Survivors Historical Child Abuse in Care Scotland Act 2021 makes provision for the recovery by Scottish Ministers of payments other than redress payments which were made due to a relevant error. The payments to which Section 97 applies include those made in respect of expert reports, payment made by way of reimbursement of costs and expenses, and legal fees in connection with a redress application or a proposed application. A relevant error can either be an error when making the payment, for example, an administrative mistake, or an error which ministers consider materially affected the decision to make the payment. This may arise in a case where the decision to make the payment was simply wrong, or in a case where the decision was right, but the information on which it was based was incorrect or misleading. These draft regulations provide for reconsiderations of decisions to make the payments mentioned in Section 97(2) of the Act, where an error, as defined in Regulation 2, may have been made. The reconsideration is to be conducted by a panel of at least two members of Redress Scotland. Before the reconsideration takes place, the beneficiary of a payment will be given 8 weeks to make written representations to the panel. If the panel finds that the decision was materially affected by error, it must redetermine it on the basis of how it would have been decided had the error not been made. In practice, we hope that this process will be rarely used. It will only be invoked in cases where there is cause to believe that there has been a material human error, or where it is thought that a decision to make a payment may have been materially affected by error because it was based on misleading or incorrect information. It is important to note that where there is an error in making a redress payment, it does not follow that all decisions to make payments linked to it are materially affected by the error. So, for example, legal fees may have been paid to a solicitor in making a redress application for a person, and that person is offered a redress payment. If it later comes to light that the application was fraudulent and no redress payment should have been made, the decision to pay the solicitor's legal fees will not be referred for reconsideration unless it is suspected that the solicitor had also fraudulently claimed the fees. In the interest of fairness, the draft instrument includes a right to review the outcome of a reconsideration process. Where a review is requested, it is to be determined by a panel of Redress Scotland, which is different to the one which conducted the reconsideration. A person who requests a review is able to provide further information and written representations to the review panel. As the committee will be aware, the importance of sound processes and fraud prevention measures was considered throughout the development of the Act. That is why we have put in place measures to ensure that appropriate financial recovery is available where payments have been made in error. These draft regulations supplement this, setting out the detail of how potential errors in non-redress payments will be considered. I seek the committee's support for this draft instrument, which is part of our preparations towards launching this scheme. I'm very happy to answer any questions, Convener.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. So can I ask if any members have any questions or comments on the draft instrument? Fergus Ewing.
Yes. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister, and to your officials. The opening statement sets out that the reason why this regulation sets out a process, assuming that there may be errors made, is that there is a recognition that fraudulent applications may be made, and that is something that cannot entirely be ruled out. I think it's fair to say, Convener, that every MSP recognises need for these payments to be made to victims of appalling sexual abuse, and that is not in dispute, nor the provision set out in the measure for payments to professionals to be not to require to be repaid in the event that unwittingly there has been a fraudulent application. But what I'd like to ask the Deputy First Minister today, and perhaps to flesh out his answer in correspondence, is a series of questions about this area. Has modelling been carried out to try to elicit what number and quantity of applications may be in the category of fraudulent? Is the threshold for applying evidence sufficient to establish entitlement to trigger a payment, perhaps lower than the standard of satisfying the balance of probability test in court? Is the Deputy First Minister satisfied that that threshold is pitched at the right level? And thirdly, I understand, and I'm afraid I don't have detail to back this up, that there has been schemes in other parts of the UK. Has the DFM or his officials considered with those administrations how to learn from their experience to minimise error, to minimise fraud, and to ensure that what we all wish to achieve is achieved without loss to the public purse through fraudulent application, given the obvious risks which may give occasion to that? I hope I've set the questions out clearly, Convener, and I did give in principle notice to the DFM that I was planning to raise this issue this morning.
Thank you, Fergus. Yes, Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Convener. There are three substantive questions that Mr Ewing puts to me, all of which are absolutely legitimate. On the first question about modelling, we have not undertaken any modelling of expectations of fraud. We have, of course, undertaken modelling of the number of applications that we consider likely that we will have to deal with in the scheme, and obviously that modelling information is enhanced by the experience that we have had with the advance payment scheme, which has given us a sense of the likelihood of applications coming forward. So that there has been modelling which has underpinned the financial memorandum for the scheme, and the modelling also influences the discussions and dialogue that we have with providers of care who we are obviously looking to make financial contributions to the scheme. What we have not modelled is the likelihood of the quantity of cases that may be affected by error. And the reason for that is that what this instrument is about is essentially about creating a proper architecture for financial control and to give financial assurance about the operation of the scheme. This is an entirely new scheme that is being created. So we have to make sure we've got the appropriate financial architecture in place, and this instrument is one element of that architecture. The second point that Mr Ewing puts to me is about the threshold of evidence. And this is an issue which we discussed extensively within the committee and chamber deliberative processes on the Act. And this is a very finely balanced question, because fundamentally the redress scheme is available to members of the public who have suffered abuse but who it is likely will be unsuccessful to be able to pursue a claim through civil courts. If the civil courts are a possibility for an individual to pursue their claim, they should do so, if that is their judgment that they have a strong and valid claim. And obviously, sufficiency of evidence will be a critical factor in that respect. So the scheme is predicated on a lower standard of proof than in the courts, but of sufficient credibility to enable a judgment to be made in each case. And obviously, that has to be accepted in good faith, but should we find that that is not the case, then obviously we need to have remedies, of which this is an appropriate instrument to take forward. And lastly, in relation to other schemes, we have engaged extensively with a range of schemes across not just the United Kingdom, but across the world to identify what are the lessons to be learnt from the administration and organisation of a number of these schemes. And we have taken a lot of that learning into the design of the Act that we that Parliament has considered and passed. The provisions that we're bringing forward here are our assessment of the legitimate provisions we have to have in place to make sure we have a robust and workable scheme.
Are you satisfied, Fergus?
Yes, I think the DFM has answered the questions I've had very, very fairly and along the lines that I kind of expected. I've just really got one follow-up question, Convener. Again, I'm not sure if this is for DFM to answer off the cuff or go away and consider it. I'm afraid I haven't researched the Act myself, but am I right in saying that a fraudulent application is not the subject of a specific statutory offence in the legislation itself, but that where there is proof that an application has been made fraud, then common law charges of fraud could be pursued? And is this something that this area, in other words, to try to make sure that we deter fraudulent applications by making it clear that the full force of the law will be applied in appropriate cases where you have the disgraceful incidents of people taking advantage of a government scheme intended for genuine victims, trying to defraud the state out of money for those victims. Is this something that the DFM, if he hasn't already discussed with the law officers, may do so in order to ensure that we're fully prepared to take action in the hopefully small number of cases where such action happens?
We've got two experts on hand, so Deputy First Minister.
It's always helpful to have experts to hand, Convener. The two points that I would make in response to Mr Ewing's question. The first is to say that there will be a further instrument coming to the committee in due course, which will look at the circumstances whereby there may be some recovery of redress payments. This instrument does not affect redress payments, but there will be an instrument coming to committee which will look at some of the issues around recovery of redress payments where there has been issues of concern raised, and they will be brought to committee in due course. The second point I would make is that should there be a suspicion that an application has been made on a fraudulent basis, that would be dealt with by common law powers in relation to the handling of fraud matters, and potentially there would be a referral to Police Scotland for consideration as a criminal offence, in line with common law powers.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to just ask if the length of time that passes between an error being identified and a payment having been made would be taken into consideration when deciding whether or not it had materially affected the claim.
That would be the case, and the regulations involve a power of discretion about whether or not there should be consideration given to the response to a potential error that has emerged. So there's no obligation in the regulations that such a course should be taken, but there is provision for consideration to be given to any steps to be taken in that respect. And obviously the issue that Mr Mundell raises with me is one of the issues that would be material to that consideration.
I think that's helpful. I just think for some of those individuals impacted, it would be distressing, for claims to be revisited, over what could be, relatively minor, minor errors in their mind. And I understand that the government's got to, and here address Scotland, have got to satisfy themselves that things have been done properly. But I just think that the threshold for error from the point of view of a survivor, you know, might be somewhat, you know, somewhat higher in terms of having to re-engage, you know, with the process. So that was all I would ask, you know, that we were mindful of.
Could I completely understand the point that's been made. Could I just clarify that the instrument in front of the committee today does not relate to redress payments. It relates to survivors. It relates to legal fees, psychology reports, other circumstantial reports that may be relevant and may have, where cost may have been incurred in error. I think the other instrument I talked about in my last answer to Mr. Ewing will be the one that looks at the question which Mr. Mundell's point relates to. So we will have an opportunity to air some of these issues again when that regulation comes to committee.
So does that...
It's possible that survivors...
Sorry, go on, Oliver. Sorry.
It would be possible for survivors to be contacted in relation to this instrument. Is that correct?
It's unlikely that that would be the case. It is much more likely it would be. I can't rule it out in all circumstances because, but it's unlikely that would be the case because it's more likely that it would be solicitors or psychologists or a provider of some form of service that would be in question here. But I think the point that Mr. Mundell raises is that due consideration has got to be given to the potential impact on survivors of any reawakening or reconsideration of a particular case, because I think we all know, and you know, Mr. Mundell has you know, been an active participant in the debate on the redress legislation. We all know the damage that has been done to survivors. We know the difficulty and the challenge of this process for survivors. So I would want to assure the committee that I don't view the application of these regulations with any automaticity. We have to exercise these regulations with care. And one of the issues that has to be considered is the very valid point that Mr. Mundell puts to me.
Thank you, Convener.
So it's unlikely that this process would be activated unless there was also consideration of trying to claim back some of the compensation monies that have been paid to survivors?
I'd say the opposite, actually, Kavira. It may be that that there may have been some error in the process which requires specific action in relation to the process, but not necessarily in relation to the payment that has been made. But there could, of course, be a relationship between the two.
But this is a process that would be initiated entirely by Redress Scotland.
Correct, yes.
And we discuss the other powers that you're talking about that we will see shortly. We can discuss then how those might be initiated.
Correct.
Yes.
And they will be, I would expect, we expect to lay those regulations shortly and for them to be probably in front of committee sometime in the new year.
Right. Okay. Right. Well, we'll look forward to that, having you come back and be with us then to discuss those issues, which I think are probably at front of mind when it comes to the survivors of this these historic cases. Any other colleagues wish to ask any questions of the Deputy First Minister? Well, on that basis, I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and for the way he's responded to the issues that have been raised by the members of the committee. And we'll move on to agenda item 3. Our next item of business is to invite the Deputy First Minister to move motion S6M01889 that the Education, Children and Young People Committee recommends that the redress for survivors, historical child abuse and care, payments materially affected by error, Scotland Regulations 2021, be approved. I would like to invite the Deputy First Minister to speak to and move the motion.
I'd move the motion in my name, Convener.
Do members have any comments? No one wants to speak, so I'm duty-bound to ask the Deputy First Minister if you'd like to wind up.
I think I've said all I need to say this morning, Convener. Thank you.
The question is that motion S6M01889 in the name of John Swinney be approved. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. The committee must now produce its report on this draft instrument. Is the committee content to delegate responsibility to the Deputy Convener and I to agree this report on behalf of the committee? Content. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister, sorry, can I thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their attendance today? We will now have a brief suspension to allow the Deputy First Minister and his officials to leave the committee. Thank you. Welcome back. For our next item of business, we will be taking evidence on the overall impact of COVID-19 on children and young people. And I'd like to welcome Jennifer King, Education Manager, Children and Family Service, Dundee City Council, and Chair of the ASN CYP Services, Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, and Laura Cavan, Chief Officer, Children and Young People Team, COSLA, Mike Corbett, National Official Scotland, NAS UWD, and Joan Trinette, Chief Social Worker, Midlothian Council, and Deputy Chair of Children and Families Standing Committee, Social Work Scotland. You're all very welcome, and you're also virtual, so we have a hybrid meeting, which is always full of interesting challenges. And so please feel free to indicate that you wish to speak, because unfortunately, not being in the room, we can't always see if you want to speak. So please do feel free to speak up to that end. But we thank you all for your time today, and we will now go to the questions. So I'm going to turn first to the Deputy Convener, Kochab Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested in, obviously there was a lot of groups that were set up in order to look at the impacts of COVID and to move forward. So I'm looking at particular at SERGE, the COVID-19 Education Recovery Group's work, and compare that to sort of pre-existing policy groups, such as the Scottish Education Council, for instance. And I'd be interested to know whether you felt that SERGE was more collaborative. Also, I'm interested to know how much influence did and does SERGE have on key policy decisions. So I'd like to put that question to Jennifer King first, and then I'd be interested to hear from Laura as well from COSLA after that. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. I'll answer it as best I can. I think that SERGE obviously was set up at a time when we needed to have, you know, a particular focus obviously on the response at the time of the pandemic. And I think it, from an ADES perspective anyway, there was very active involvement with the range of partners at that time, including for those with additional support needs and those who were care experienced. I'm not sure that I could honestly answer and say whether it was or make a comparison, if you like, between SERGE and the Scottish Education Council. What I would say as a member of one of the SERGE subgroups was that I think it was a very collaborative experience.
Okay, thank you. And do you think that, I'd be interested about the influence then on key policy decisions from the Scottish Government. Did you feel that it did have that status and it was listened to?
Yes, I think it did. I mean, I think that I have a bit of echo. Sorry. I think it did in terms of the guidance. Again, I'm speaking from an ADES perspective, but in terms of the guidance, which was then subsequently updated, it was fairly dynamic, I think, the process. Sometimes that was challenging because we were dealing, you know, having to mediate that, if you like, from the perspective of ultimately implementation for schools and nurseries. But I think it was a dynamic process, and I think it did, at the time when we were having to manage a number of different factors, I think it did have influence, yes.
Thank you. Laura? Is Laura?
Yeah. Thanks. The Education Recovery Group had a clear role in taking the scientific evidence from the advisory subgroup and translating it into the practical options that could be taken forward to support learners during the period of school closure and then reopening. And it had a clear role in terms of its terms of reference and reporting arrangements to both Scottish Minister and Scottish Ministers and COSLA leaders. And the subgroups and the work streams that were under it worked effectively to develop guidance and was really collaborative in the way that it did that, and also had the benefit of working across the Children and Families Collective Leadership Group as well, and making sure that those two groups were able to, from the shared membership, I suppose, of organisations on each of them, were able to have like a coherent approach to supporting children and families over that period. You asked about the difference between the CERT role and existing groups such as the Scottish Education Council. Like Jennifer, I don't think that there is a clear answer to that because they're very different purposes, very different circumstances. One of the benefits for the of the Education Recovery Group's leadership was that it was co-chaired by both the Deputy First Minister and then the Cabinet Secretary, and now the Cabinet Secretary, and the COSLA Children and Young People spokesperson. And that allowed for consistent messaging across both spheres of government in that challenging landscape. And the Scottish Education Council isn't chaired in the same way, because I had sought co-chairing for that, but that wasn't taken forward, which is perhaps a little bit disappointing given the learning through the pandemic and the need for a whole system approach to supporting children and young people. The Education Council's voice through it, so I think that that's definitely something that has enhanced and grown through the learning during the pandemic.
I think I caught most of that. I think so. Thank you very much for that. I'm just going to go on to something slightly different while I've still got my turn, as it were. And I'd just like to remind everyone of my register of interest. I am currently an associate member of the NASUWT. So I'm going to come to Mike. Read your written submission there, and I just want to sort of like have a look at any strategy going forward for effective recovery is going to require an effective focus on the workforce. So Mike Corbett, could you give us sort of like the top three sort of the top three tips that you could give us on how workforce planning and how we can make sure that the workforce in education is taken care of as we recover.
Thank you. In relation to that question, I think what we would be saying initially is that, and this relates to, I think, question 16 about new approaches needed. And I think there's often reference made to other countries and how they do well with the Finnish education system, for example. And at the heart of that is respect for teachers. I think there's much greater respect for teachers in other countries like Finland, and I think that's a new approach that we need with our workforce. And I think, you know, key at the moment amongst those new approaches would be to pay our teachers properly. And I think there's plenty around at the moment about the current pay offer and how it is a significant real terms pay cut, and that has really upset and annoyed a number of teachers at the moment, given what they've put in during the pandemic. Beyond that, even before the pandemic, but exacerbated by it, have been workload considerations. In our surveys, even before the pandemic, workload issues came up as the number one concern for teachers. That has been exacerbated by everything that's happened during the pandemic. I appreciate that the OECD review has touched on the fact that Scottish teachers have more class contact time than, you know, almost any other OECD country. And there is a plan to address that and a proposed reduction in class contact time. But there is no timescale for that other than within this parliament. So we would want that to be urgently addressed. And alongside that, as a third point, then, I think I would suggest that we need a reduction in class sizes as well, because if anything, the pandemic has shown that many, many pupils need individualised or small group attention in order for them to progress as well as they can. And if we're genuinely going to do that, we really need to seriously reduce class sizes in many of our schools.
Thanks for that, Mike. Just a small supplementary, and that's my last bit, convener. So, I mean, you'll know that I was a teacher for many years and, you know, sort of know fine well about sort of workload, but the Curriculum for Excellence Working Group on Tackling Bureaucracy, so, I mean, that document's been available for a while. So what do you think are the barriers to actually implementing it and making a difference to tackling bureaucracy?
Well, commitment is one of them, because I actually was on the group originally back in, it started in 2013, produced a very good report about the drivers of workload and how to tackle them. And sadly, a number of local authorities simply seemed to ignore the first report, and that led to a second report in 2015, reiterating many of those key issues. But if groups or individuals are going to ignore what was agreed at top level as a number of very good recommendations, we think they really need statutory force or something similar if they're to be taken on board. Because it's a frustration that I know Professor Ken Muir shared in recent meetings we had with him about work we did alongside him at the time. And very good reports with good recommendations were produced, but unfortunately, many did not do enough to take those recommendations forward.
Thank you. I think what I'm hearing from that is that there seems to be a little bit of a disconnect between sort of like overarching policy and the way that it's implemented at local levels. So that's very interesting to know that. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Co-Cab. Bob.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'd probably like to ask a couple of questions to Laura Cavan from COSLA, but it was in relation to funds that have been put in for education recovery, both through COVID and beyond. Just looking at my notes, I know it was an £80 million COVID fund through the period up until now, which has now been made permanent next year, so in the core budget next year. And that suggests that has been employing through COVID and can employ permanently from April next year 1,400 teachers and 250 support staff. So leave that sitting there. There's also a £65.5 million new release of cash for April next year, again in the core budget, which will give 1,000 additional teachers and 500 support staff. So that's 2,400 more teachers and 750 more support staff. I mean, I suspect the demands are such that these are very, very much needed. And you could always do with more, and I absolutely get that. But what I'd really like to know, Convener, is from the staff that are already in post and for those that are likely to be recruited, what view COSLA takes in how they should be deployed? Should they be deployed generally across the education estate, primary and secondary schools, or local authorities looking to target the use of teachers and support staff for, say, additional support needs or to free up teacher time elsewhere? What's the sense from COSLA about how that money has been spent to date, but probably more importantly, how that money should be spent going forward? And I'll probably have some questions related to that, depending on what the thoughts of Laura Cavan is.
Thanks. So my answer to that is going to be probably one that you'd expect, and that we'd expect that to be a local decision based on the needs of individual local authorities, individual schools, individual learners, and the setups that they've got and the supports that they've got around them. So I don't think I can necessarily give you a clear answer on that beyond the fact that local authorities know their areas and the needs in their areas best. So we need to ensure that flexibility is there for them to make that decision.
Thanks, Laura. I did anticipate you would say that, and that sounds eminently reasonable. I also see from your submission that there are significant reporting requirements already on the monies that local authorities get, and you're concerned about any additional reporting requirements. But, you know, this is Scotland's Education Committee. One of the things that we're seeking to understand is when you have such a significant investment of £145.5 million additional to a core education budget going to local authorities, this committee wants to know how that money is deployed. And we get that there's need for local flexibility. So do you think it would be reasonable for COSLA or for local authorities to give some reasonable details on how many primary school teachers have been employed, how many secondary school teachers have been employed, how many additional support needs staff have been deployed, what the purpose and role of those staff are, and what a positive outcome would look like to that spend? I know that sounds hugely bureaucratic, and I know schools know
their kids best and local authorities know their local communities best, and I get all that. But at some point, this committee will say to the Scottish Government, you've put that money in, what results have you got for it? And we can't just scrutinise the government. We've also got to shine a light on how local authorities and COSLA view that spend and what the benefits of it have been through COVID. So perhaps you could say for the £80 million that has already been spent during COVID, what the benefits of that have been and what you'd anticipate this committee could do to measure positive outcomes in the years ahead for that significant additional spend.
Teaching numbers are published each year, I believe each year. Don't hold me to that, I'll clarify that in writing. So you will have that information to hand, and I do believe that that's broken down in the way that you're asking for there. So hopefully that would help the committee to understand how that's been deployed at a local level. And in terms of the outcomes, I think that there's a lot of work going on just now to understand the wider impacts of COVID on and the associated restrictions on children and young people and their learning and their health and well-being. So I think that that's something that we're definitely looking at, and there are groups, I think, under the Children and Families Collective Leadership Group looking at outcomes frameworks and so on for children and young people.
Laura, I wouldn't push further on that, but I know it's a very detailed question for you to respond to at committee, but if COSLA could have a think about that and perhaps give us additional information, that would be genuinely really welcome, because we're not seeking to be awkward in relation to this. I get that the money still means there's challenges, but we do need to follow the money from government to local authorities and local authorities to delivering at a local level. So any additional information you could give would be helpful. On that point, though, we do have Mike Corbett here. From a union perspective, can I ask Mike Corbett whether there's been discussions with union representatives and local authorities or COSLA, given the amount of additional money going into the system, and quite rightly so, because the need is clearly there, about how that money is best deployed and making sure there's permanent contracts, and whether that's focused at additional support needs or whether that's focused in lost learning in secondary school when they're going towards exams, or is it in primary school, or is it all of the above? But I suppose the important thing, convener, is what discussions is there between local authorities, COSLA and union representatives, the best way to shape and direct that spend?
Thanks. I think what we would say is that the strategy at the moment has almost missed a key step. I mean, there's often tension between, if you like, national prescription and local flexibility. But for us, the models that you see being used in the United States and the Netherlands, where they seem to have committed more funding in the first place to doing the research, you know, whether that's through questionnaires, diagnostic assessments or whatever, to then identify exactly where the funding should be targeted. We think that step's really been missed. We've not really had that national guidance, and then it's been left to individual local authorities to decide, well, should the money be spent on recruiting permanent teachers? Should it be spent on small group tuition, on social and emotional support for kids, improved technology, support for staff, whatever it might be? All of these things, you know, in many cases, absolutely the right thing to do. Yes, local need needs to be taken into account. But as I say, we feel that there's not really been that properly researched first step to identify the need, or at least to aid local authorities and schools to identify the need before deciding on where the funding goes. I'll give you just one off-the-cuff example we know of, where a school recruited a biology teacher that they did not need because they felt they were under pressure to recruit another permanent teacher because the government had told the council you need to recruit X number of permanent teachers. So as I say, that kind of thing suggests we've not quite got the strategy right. And the involvement of trade union reps at local level, I would say, is patchy. Some councils and schools doing excellent work there, but others, you know, we're not involved at all.
I'm pleased Mike Corbett mentioned temporary teachers and permanent teachers, because one of the issues for local authorities over the years has been, and the ask of unions has been, there's many, many temporary teachers out there who are not getting permanent contracts. So this is surely positive that a lot of temporary teachers can have that contractual basis put made permanent. So I hope that's something Mr Corbett would welcome. But this money's been spent in real time, I suppose. So I've got absolute sympathy for that audit of where the greatest needs are and how that's deployed strategically. I get that, Mr Corbett, but I also get the money's been spent in real time. So therefore, we have to get the money out and use it as quickly as possible. Could that be an argument for, and for clarity, if you're, I'm not making this argument, but it might follow on from Mr Corbett's point, that as we're spending this money in real time and how we're still analysing the needs within the education sector where it's best to be strategically spent, that if some of those new posts were temporary contracts, so you don't lock in a strategic decision when you're still deciding how best to deploy resources, would that be a reasonable thing to do? Now, Mr Corbett, my preference would always be permanent, full-time, contracted teachers at a local authority level, given that absolute security. But I'm just conscious, you mentioned there about locking in decisions on permanent posts when perhaps we're not sure how best to direct that money. So from a union perspective, is there an argument to be made for some of this new money that's coming forward initially to be used for temporary or short-term appointments as we start to audit or assess where the greatest needs are across local authorities and for our children?
Thanks. I mean, you know, we obviously would like to see more permanent teachers employed. Again, if you make an international comparison, in Finland, they have a proportionately far more permanent teachers employed than we do here, and a bigger teaching workforce. So obviously, you know, we should be moving towards that as part of broader recovery. But your specific point about is there a role for, you know, temporary staffing or whatever it might be? As I say, it could be additional one-to-one support at end of day classes for existing staff that are taking those. So that there are other things that can be done that might be the suitable thing in an individual school right now, but that wouldn't get away from our overarching desire over time to have more permanent teachers in post.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Mike Corbett, 1 in 8. I mean, I asked a parliamentary question about this at the summer time, and I was told by the government that 1 in 8 of all of our teachers are on temporary contracts. So there are people in classrooms right now doing a job of work who do not have the security of a permanent contract. Now, when I asked about this in the chamber, quite rightly, the government minister said, well, we've now sorted that, because that money that was temporary and a one-off in a pot is now part of the core budget. So what I would say to you, Mike, is I'm really surprised to hear you be so soft on the issue of getting those temporary contracts to become permanent contracts. I'm really surprised the union isn't much harder on this issue.
Well, as I've said, ultimately we do want more permanent contracts than have actually been offered.
These people on temporary contracts. Why are you not saying these people that are on temporary contracts should be on permanent contracts now? Because I think that's exactly what the Scottish Government is expecting that local authorities are going to do, and you as a union should be pushing that, surely.
And we are pushing it if that's what is required.
It didn't sound very much like that to me. It sounded very weak. Can I go to Laura Carvin on that same question? What's the COSLA position on this? Are we seeing those temporary contract teachers get permanent contracts?
I'm happy to come back to you in writing, because it would be something that our employers team would have more information on, rather than our children and policy.
Do you have any sense? I mean, you're in a key role with COSLA as Chief Officer of Children and Young People. I mean, do you have any sense as to whether there is a move to get these temporary contract teachers onto permanent contracts? Is that something that you're aware of?
It's something that I would rather follow up in writing, to be honest, because apart from anything else...
It's fundamental, I think, to the discussion around COVID recovery. That these teachers who've done a fantastic job, and we've done a lot of work on on the workload that teachers have been bearing, that they deserve permanent contracts. I'm being encouraged to be as brief as I'm encouraging other people to be, and quite rightly so. So I'm going to go to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. Okay, some of my questions kind of like follow on or connect a little bit with what Bob was talking about there. My first question is for Mike. Previously in evidence we've heard that there's been a lot of really, really good work by teachers, you know, building relationships with pupils during the pandemic while the schools were out, but also that continued when they returned to school as well there, with, you know, a lot of it being about wellbeing, being about pupils' mental health, being about young people being in the right place to be able to actually learn. We did also hear a bit of evidence as well there, kind of anecdotal stuff around the fact that teachers are starting to feel that they're possibly losing some of that good work, that there's a pressure there now for academic stuff. So a lot more focus on literacy and numeracy at primary or at secondary school on exams there as well. So I was just wondering, you know, would you say that's been teachers' experience recently? And whether teachers are feeling as well that wellbeing and mental health are a high enough priority, and also I suppose whether expectations of people's progress has actually changed through the pandemic. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you. Probably worth just foregrounding these comments with a little bit of personal information, in that up until the October break, I was a teacher on the front line and only took up this post after the October break. So I was in amongst it for most of the pandemic, as well as at the same time being an elected lay officer of the union, and so hearing stories from around the country about what was happening elsewhere. And I think what you characterise there is probably very accurate. There's no doubt that in the early part of the pandemic, and certainly when we were in both lockdowns, the health and well-being of pupils was at the forefront of everyone's mind. And I don't think there's any doubt about that. And that did feed into work that was done when pupils returned after both lockdowns. But I think you do touch on what is an increasing concern, is that there is a sense of, well, we're back to normal now, the kids are back in school, therefore we get back to doing all the things we did before. And some of those things are pressurised assessments, especially SQA assessments. And we've obviously had some concerns just begin to be expressed, you know, just in this past week or so about secondary schools that are now moving towards prelim exams or mock exams, which obviously they feel they need to do because they feel they need to prepare the pupils properly for what we're expecting, which is still a full set of exams. But undoubtedly, you know, that brings back a lot of pressure on both the pupils and on the teachers as well. And it's perhaps one of the reasons why so many of our members are reporting that they're utterly exhausted, because they are trying, I think, to still maintain the relationships with their kids and that are in front of them, and keep those relationships good and look after their well-being, alert anyone to any issues they see, while at the same time doing everything that they did before in preparing kids for exams or in the primary sector, literacy or numeracy assessments, etc. So that pressure seems to come from a variety of places. Sometimes it's within the school, sometimes it's the local authority, sometimes it's the parents and wider society. But that pressure is there and it's having an impact. And as I say, I think it's having an impact on the teachers as well as the pupils.
So I'd be quite interested, Mike, then, are there ways, how do you feel we could actually work towards helping to alleviate that? What could we look at doing that would be helpful to our teachers?
That's where I think the additional staffing is required, so that, you know, the pupils who are identified as struggling in some way, whether it's academically or in vocational skills or in terms of their mental health and well-being, that we have staff on hand to work closely with them, whether that's on a one-to-one basis or a small group basis, to help them. Because that's not something that, touched on class sizes earlier, that's not something that your teacher with 30 kids in front of them can realistically do at the moment.
That's great. Thanks very much for that, Mike. My next question, convener, is for probably Laura and Jennifer, possibly as well there. What I'm interested in asking you is about how families and children and our young people are being meaningfully included in the decisions on how local authorities, their schools and their children's services are approaching recovery. So, you know, how are we progressing with that just now? How well is it going at this moment in time, and what more is it that we can do?
We've had a lot of engagement at both a national level at COSLA, and local authorities have had individual work that they've undertaken with children and families so that they can really listen to the impacts that it's had on them and how they can be best supported as we move into this next phase. One of the things that I think is really important that's come through really strongly from children and young people is the rejection of the kind of the catch-up narrative and instead a real need to focus on providing the right support for them and the support that they need and want. In terms of support and relating to your previous question to Mike there, there over the past year and a half, a number of new services and supports have been put in place for children and young people and their families to support their mental health and wellbeing through the Children and Young People's Mental Health and Wellbeing Joint Delivery Board that COSLA and Scottish Government jointly chair. And so that's been a real enhancement of the support that's available locally and developed through work with children and young people through engagement with them, consultation with them around what they need. I think Jennifer, I'll probably have a bit more detail on some of the applications of that locally, but it's certainly something that's been at the forefront of our thinking.
And to Jennifer.
Yeah. I think with regard to the involvement of parents and families, that's been a process that was initiated, I suppose, during the pandemic period with a lot of outreach from schools and local authorities to parents and carers, depending on their own circumstances. I think what's happened since then is that there's been a lot of work done. I mean, I attended the parent council chair in my own local authority last night. So there's ongoing updates and feedback from parent council chairs to the local authority and to head teachers with regard to what is happening in terms of recovery, how parents are finding communication, for example, updates on forthcoming assessments, and the ongoing implementation of support for children and young people's mental health and wellbeing. I think schools have continued to do regular surveys, albeit that we want to be mindful that we don't want overload of parents and carers in being asked questions, but that certainly has been a feature, I think, that has evolved both in terms of using technology as well as phone conversations and other means of contact. And then at an individual level, children and young people and their parents are involved where there is a requirement for individual planning, for example, through review meetings or team around the child meetings. So I think it happens at a number of different levels. I think the partnership with our third sector providers has been critically important throughout this period of time, particularly those that do represent parents and families, a number of them. Are providers of a range of services, including those for mental health and wellbeing, including those for children and young people with additional support needs and those who are caring experienced. And they've been a critical source, I think, of supporting both decision making and planning, as well as feedback on how families are responding to the support that has been put in place.
That's great. Thanks very much. And just you'd mentioned ASN there as well, Jennifer. I'm just wondering, at the kind of higher levels where we have working groups with teachers, Scottish Government officials, etc. there as well, how well represented are the is the ASN community there?
I think, well, national, so do you mean parents or do you mean just ASN generally?
So whether,
just to clarify your question.
Yes, yeah, so whether that's parents, whether that's people with specialist knowledge, or whether it's directly, whether we're talking directly about people with neurodiversity, etc.
From my experience, I think that those who represent a fairly wide range of additional support needs perspectives, if you like, are involved in policy making and decision making, as like the Additional Support for Learning Implementation Group has a good representation, I think, from National Parent Forum Scotland, professional associations, the National Autism Implementation Team, OSLA, ADES. So that's fairly widely represented and is consulted on in relation to wider educational matters, if you like. I think that I'm the ADES rep on the collective leadership for children, young people and families. And again, I think additional support needs is a feature, if you like, within the feedback and discussions and planning that takes place there. So I think we need to keep it at the forefront. I think the forthcoming and the current consultation on education reform is going to be critical, that additional support needs and wider equity, if you like, is forefront in the consultation and any forthcoming decisions around that. But I think in terms of representation of ASN in the range of policy groups, I think it's fairly well balanced at the moment.
Convener, just a very, very short one in that there. I'm wondering as well specifically about the representation in the National Teacher Panel and the Children and Young People Education Council. I don't know actually if that's a question for you, Jennifer, or if it would be a different member of the panel that would be able to answer that for me. Thank you.
I'm not sure that I can answer that question for you. I don't know the detail. I could find out, but I don't know the detail at the moment.
Okay, thanks. I don't think I've got any volunteers in that one, Stephen, so that's maybe a question for another day. But thanks very much for your input there. Very helpful. Thanks.
Thank you, Stephanie. Just before I go to a different line of questions that I've got in mind, I wanted to go back to Bob Doris's question line, because as you can all tell, I'm pretty agitated about temporary contracts for teachers, because these are, in many cases, younger teachers who are starting off in their careers and need some security around their employment in order to make other decisions and plan their lives going forward. So I wonder, while I've got Jennifer King, can I ask Jennifer King, are Dundee City Council translating some of those temporary contracts with this certitude that they've now got around budgeting? Are they now translating some of those temporary contract teachers onto permanent contracts?
I don't know that I can give you the exact detail on that. There is recruitment underway at the moment, along with looking at, I know that the council policy certainly is that staff who are on temporary contracts are those who should be given consideration within the council's recruitment policy in relation to any permanent contract. So, but I'm not in the position to give you a fuller answer on that at the moment.
As far as you're aware, without being too specific around numbers and so forth, is that happening? Are those contracts now being made permanent in Dundee?
That might be the case for some, but I couldn't give you the exact details of numbers.
Because Bob Doris is right. I'm going to bring Bob Doris back in a minute. I mean, Bob Doris is right, you see, because so the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament are sanctioning all this money to be spent. So this money is coming to Scotland's local authorities. you know, I'm all for holding the Scottish Government to account, but at the end of the day, the employer is the local authority. Now, although, you know, what I've got all kinds of gestures off to the side here from colleagues who want to come in. But at the end of the day, getting these contracts made permanent is very important. So what I'd like to ask Laura Cavan to do, and I didn't do this when we're talking about this, is I think if you could write to the committee, please, and tell us whether or not this move from temporary to permanent is happening, and also how many vacancies are there? How many teacher vacancies are there in Scotland over and above the temporary contracts? I think we'd like to know that. I think it's fundamental to the role of our committee to see that every penny of money that's spent in education is delivered in terms of having the right number of teachers in classroom with the permanency of contract and the security of tenure to get on with their lives as well. I'm going to bring in Bob Doris, and I can see Michael Mara. This is a very important issue, so if you...
No, I will be brief. I think, just be dispassionate about it, the committee just wants to analyse the impact the spend is having, and I think that's important. A number I didn't give, convener, is there was actually £240 million for staffing during COVID-19 for additional staffing, and it's £145.5 million going into a core funding budget. So the reason I put that on the record is we have to make sure when we compare figures from one year to the next, we're comparing apples with apples. But I think underlying all this is we need a robust reporting exercise from local authorities and how many temporary posts they have and what areas they are from the year before COVID through COVID to the first year after COVID, in a way that's not bureaucratic, but in a way that... But
it's fundamental, isn't it? Knowing how many teachers there are.
But in a way that allows us to measure the impact and what's actually happening on the ground. But I think there has to be a consistent measure, because all the politicians around this table can pick different figures and use them as we see fit. The important thing for me is we have a dispassionate, factual, robust reporting exercise on this, and I don't feel we have that just now.
What you're hearing, witnesses in the committee today, is lessons learned from Audit Scotland, that we are focused very much on what happens to the money and what the outcomes are. Michael Mara.
Thanks, Convener. I would welcome, I think, the agreement between yourself and Mr Doris in terms of that a report should be forthcoming and we get some form of information from COSLA on that. I just want to make my point to yourself, Convener, that as I declare an interest in this as a councillor in Dundee City Council, who's the Cabinet Secretary has just cut over £4 million of the education budget for Dundee City Council. So actually speaking to Mrs King here, Jennifer King, and asking her whether people are moving to permanent contracts, I think that's particularly challenging in Dundee, given the size of cut, the direct cut that's been made. So if we can reflect some of that in the context, I think it's absolutely key. In the particular circumstances across 9 local authorities who've had massive cuts to those budgets in the last week, I think we need to really... address in that report as well.
These are fundamental issues that we all want to get to the truth of the matter, and for the sake of Scotland's young children and young people. On that note, I'm now going to turn to Joan Trenent, because in Joan Trenent, in Social Work Scotland's submission to our committee, there was some interesting information about child protection, which I'd like you to address, please, for the committee. I'll just quote from your submission, and then you'll know what I'm referring to. On page 31, an increase in demand such as child protection referrals in IRDs, which are initial referral discussions, but this is not translated into an increase in child protection registration and related activity. Referrals were received from police rather than the previous main referrer of education. Now, I'm concerned about that, plus the fact that it goes on to say overall number of children becoming looked after, children reduced. I've got one question for you, which I'd like you to address, Joan. Why did this happen in the pandemic? And what's happening now? That's two questions. I lied. Two questions. Why and what is happening now?
Okay, good morning, Convener, thank you. Yes, it's obviously been a very challenging time during 2 lockdowns. Where social workers continue to do their social work duties, we'd like to offer reassurance on that across the whole of Scotland in relation to making sure that those most vulnerable were visited at their home, if that's what was required, and going into houses as well at times, which was very challenging for everyone. In relation to child protection referrals and IRDs, coming from police, that's not unusual. Education are our normal referrers, and that's because children are seen every single day in education. You know, when we had lockdown, your children were in schools. We had the hubs open, obviously, for those who were vulnerable, although not all chose to attend, and also for the essential workforce. However, not all children were seen all the time. Therefore, you know, in order to initiate an interagency referral discussion, people need to see children, people need to receive information, and that information was often coming through police incidents rather than through children coming in and reporting that to their teachers, etc. I know what was happening, and speaking with colleagues in Social Work Scotland, that across the board, you know, the public protection offices were holding more regular meetings in relation to monitor this activity that was happening and reporting it on a weekly basis. And indeed, you know, we reported to and we still do report to Scottish Government on a weekly basis in relation to the numbers, child protection registrations, how many are deregistered, how many IRDs we have. So is it that information is shared across the whole of Scotland? But I would have to say, from a social work perspective, that was not unusual. That was what we predicted would happen, because when you don't see children, you know, you don't get that information. The information comes mainly from children talking to adults. So we need others, you know, in order to do that. It's everyone's responsibility. During lockdown, though, people were not out and about and, you know, sharing information. So, yeah, that is part of the reason as to why, you know, the main referrer became police rather than education. We are now seeing that is starting to improve. You know, children are back in schools again. But I suppose I just want to highlight that, you know, COVID is still here. It's very much an issue. We're dealing with it every single day. You know, we have COVID outbreaks happening every single day in schools, across social work centres, etc. as well. So we're not back to full capacity, but we are, you know, we are undertaking our public protection duties in relation to managing risk and ensuring that children and young people who are at risk, that we're attending to their immediate risks and dealing with that as quickly as possible.
If I could, Joan, you know, when classes were online, when teachers were actually getting an eye almost into the homes of children, is it the case that because of the digital divide that there was, that became apparent during the first lockdown, and, you know, I know there were efforts to try and remedy that as we went into the second longer lockdown, but what I'm a bit confused about is why teachers couldn't see very clearly into some homes what was going on. You know, you can tell. I mean, these are professional people. I have the highest respect for our teachers. They understand something about children. Weren't they able to detect from the digital experience they were having, the interface they were having, that there were maybe issues that they should be referring?
I would just agree with you that teachers are hugely professional and they are very aware of child protection. However, when you're sitting in a house and, you know, the potential abuser is sitting at the table next to you, i.e. parent, because, you know, in the vast majority of times, anybody who's been abused, it will be a parent. And if they're sitting in the house because they're not at their work because of lockdown, etc., it's really, really difficult and challenging to identify what that need is. But also, you know, you have domestic abuse, which is also highlighted within the report. You know, people can't tell us if the abuser's sitting there, you know, so you need really, really skilled workforce, and you also need a disclosure. And, you know, physically seeing children will never ever replace anything else in relation to identifying child protection. So, you know, it was a monitoring system, but it's not an ideal position, I suppose, is what I'm saying. Sitting in a classroom gives children much more opportunity to talk and share their experience.
I'm going to give you a break here, Joan, and come back to you in a moment, but Mike Corbett wants to come in.
Thanks, Convener. Just briefly on that point about the digital time that we had and the time online with teaching, the reality of the experience for the vast majority of teachers was that pupils chose not to put cameras on, and therefore you did not often have that view into the household, and that obviously in all sorts of ways made it much more difficult to make a judgment on whether there was an issue that was worth reporting.
That's a very good point, and I appreciate you intervening to make that point. Joan, if I can turn to another aspect of your evidence, and that's this in relation to people who are vulnerable. I'm looking at page 32 of your evidence, where you describe specific challenges with children in need. And you make an allusion, really, that there are groups of young people who could become at risk on that page, which is, I think, a recognised reality. What steps are needed at a policy level to enable this set of families to be given early intervention support to prevent problems? So what I'll just repeat that. What steps are needed at a policy level to enable this group of families to be given early intervention support to prevent problems?
Yeah, thank you. I think, you know, when we all work under, you know, GIRFET, getting it right for every child, I think, you know, early intervention and prevention is something that we continuously talk about. We're heartened to hear that there's funding coming in relation to, you know, widening that support. The promise also talks about early intervention and prevention. We talk about scaffolding families who previously might not have hit the threshold for social work, but, you know, for family support. We need to turn this huge ship in relation to diverting resources into early intervention and prevention. That is a real challenge when we're still dealing with crisis day on, day out. You know, as I've been a social worker for 20-odd years, we need, and it's a statutory duty to manage the crisis, but we need to separate something so that we can get into families earlier. And the promise, what it's done, is also give us that permission to scaffold families for a longer time. We've been through times where scaffolding wasn't seen as, you know, that popular, as in that the state shouldn't intervene if they didn't need to. But what we now recognise is that some families will dip in and out of our service, and that is fine, and that is what we should be doing. So, you know, the promise is one area certainly in relation to diverting that, and I hope that we can build on that and, you know, divert resources into that early, that true early intervention and prevention, because, you know, we've got poverty, you know, which is a huge issue, and poverty does lead, and, you know, can lead people into crisis. We want to nip that in the bud at the earliest opportunity. So, you know, that would be my ask, convener, is in relation to that, a real commitment to doing that, and giving everyone permission to say that that's the journey that we're now taking in relation to going forward.
Are you saying that early intervention had gone out of fashion, gone out of favour?
I don't think so. I think, you know, what you'll see from this report, convener, is that at this moment in time we have a real challenge because, you know, referrals are increasing rapidly. Now, what we need to do, because we're still in COVID, as I keep saying, is what we need to do is some analysis as to why these referrals are happening. Anecdotally, from my own perspective, I know that referrals are coming in relation to money, you know, because people are in crisis, etc. We know that there's money coming into local authorities in relation to the winter fund, poverty, etc. But that is increasing referrals. That could be early intervention and prevention. You know, we want to separate that from the real child protection stuff that is coming in. So, you know, funding in relation to making sure that our workforce is, you know, has the resources within it in relation to managing that first, rather than just waiting for things to escalate. But I wouldn't say it's went out of fashion. I think it's a priority. You know, crisis always comes first, and then early intervention and prevention is something that we all want to do and is at the forefront of our thinking, but doesn't always get the priority that it deserves.
You're talking about priority, focus and resource allocation, really, aren't you?
Yes.
On page 36 of your evidence, you talk about I'll just read the sentence. Despite the above restrictions, many carers noted that for some children, removal of the pressures of managing school resulted in stress and reducing in stress and anxiety and an increase in engagement with learning via remote routes. That's a very interesting observation. What are the lessons that we should take away from that experience that you're reporting in your evidence for some children?
Yes, convener. In relation to that, it's a really interesting topic that we had the discussion with at Social Work Scotland. It tended to focus on children with ASD, autism, where sometimes walking into large schools can be quite traumatic for them. Lots of children there, lots of noise, so it heightens their anxiety. So for a proportion, parents reported back to us that this made life easier for them, and they were able to do that learning. So what we need to take on board in relation to consultation with our education colleagues is that we need to look for these smaller places where children with ASD are able to go into education and not have that heightened state of anxiety. That is easier said than done, obviously, but you know, that would be our aim, certainly, you know, from my own perspective in relation to working collaboratively with education. That's what we're looking at, because we certainly received that information within Midlothian. So yeah, there was some really good learning. Obviously, conversely, you know, it didn't work for other children as well, you know, but it was an interesting fact, and one that I think we need to keep a hold of in relation to our future planning for children with ASD in particular.
Thank you very much. Yes, Kokab.
Thank you, convener. I just wanted to, the sentence on page 29, what we do know that this has been a lengthy and traumatic period of national and worldwide insecurity. I think that's quite important to sort of highlight that. And then I was looking at sort of like, you know, parental mental health, domestic abuse, problematic parental alcohol or substance misuse. So I think obviously with the education young, you know, with our remit, we're trying to be as holistic as possible. And it's not always, you know, schools have a major part to play in the recovery, but I'm interested in your perspectives about sort of like a multidisciplinary approach. And that obviously you've touched on it with early intervention and social work and community support services. So there's so many agencies. I'm just a wee bit concerned that we're not as joined up as we could be. Have you got any perspectives on that?
Yes, if you would like me to try and answer that. Yeah.
Yes, Joan, yeah.
Okay, yeah. I think there's a huge amount of work being done collaboratively across Scotland in relation to ensuring that we are not duplicating work. We have learnt lessons from before where everybody's doing certain, you know, doing the same thing. So, you know, your children's services board, whatever it's called different things in different local authorities, but the GIRFET board that's called out My Way, make sure that we have, you know, third sector, the voluntary sector, education, community lifelong learning and employability, housing, mental health services. We have the whole tranche round and health services, obviously, around the table to ensure that we provide a holistic whole systems approach to supporting families. You know, if we're going to do early intervention and prevention in its truest form, we need to think of families and no individuals, which I think we've all been guilty of in the past, you know, identifying a individual rather than looking at the whole family system and making sure that we support the whole family in relation to going forward. So, you know, certainly that's a focus in Social Work Scotland as to what, how we're all talking across the whole of Scotland. So that, you know, going forward, I would hope that that would be the way the way that we're going to adopt and how we're going to measure our resources going forward, putting them all together holistically to support our communities.
I was reassured by your answer. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Ross Greer.
I'd like to start just by going back to your last line of question there, convener, around the children and families for whom lockdown actually provided an opportunity for engagement with education that wasn't happening there before. This is a point that the Children's Commissioner made to us a few weeks ago. So, Joan, I'm interested in your perspective on this. You're talking about the need, quite rightly, for us to bear this in mind, for social work teams to bear it in mind with their future strategies for schools, etc. But schools have now been back to something approaching normal since August. In-person learning has been the default since that point. From what you've seen and heard so far, have those families who were children who were re-engaged with education, perhaps for the first time in quite some time, through lockdown, through remote learning, has that learning actually been, the learning at local authority at school level, has that been preserved, or are we already seeing instances of children who were disengaged pre-pandemic, engaged by the unique circumstances of remote learning? Are they starting to disengage again because the adaptations that were made for them have not been continued? Or are there good examples out there of schools, local authorities, social work teams, etc., who have managed to continue that link with those for whom it was quite challenging before March of last year?
Okay, thank you for that question. I would probably have to go back to Social Work Scotland to gain more of my colleagues' overview in relation to this. I can speak from a from a Midlothian perspective, but I can't speak from Social Work Scotland in relation to the return to work and relation, you know, how their learning has gone since they've returned to work. I don't know, do you want me to give an anecdotal in relation to Midlothian, or would you prefer to have a Scotland-wide perspective and I could get that back to you in writing?
If I could be a bit cheeky and ask for both, that would be great. If you've got an anecdote you could offer us now, I'm sure we'd be interested in it. But yeah, a follow-up in writing would be great.
Yeah, and we do have one. I mean, one particular school, a high school that springs to mind, was someone who contacted us at the centre in relation to highlighting this, where three young people who had you know, had really enjoyed their learning during lockdown. So, you know, that head teacher has made a small provision in the school. She's been very, very fortunate. She has a school that has capacity to do that in relation to engaging both the parents and the young people. And we've got family support workers in there as well to get the children back in. That has been staggering times that they enter the school, etc. Because what, you know, what parents have come back and said to us is that these three young individuals in particular really, really struggle to walk into the high school at the same time as everybody else, especially after a lockdown. So they've made minor adjustments, which appear to have had dividends, good dividends at this moment in time. But yeah, it's early days yet. And I suppose while school have been back, we are still impacted every day with COVID in relation to, you know, some classes not being able to take place, you know, schools with kids with additional support needs, etc. Two members of staff off, etc. That can have a huge impact in relation to, you know, the whole class attendance. So, but I will go back to Social Work Scotland and get something in writing and be able to submit that to you.
Thanks very much. That'd be much appreciated. Turning now to the broader question, this committee have been struggling for the last few weeks with how we distinguish between the substantial amount of anecdotal evidence that we've now received and rigorous verifiable data that's been collected on just exactly how the pandemic has affected children, young people and their families, precisely because of the issues that we've just discussed, where we know across the board it's had negative consequences. There are unique circumstances where it's actually done the opposite, but even for those for whom this has been harmful, it's not had the same, it's not inflicted the same level of harm on everyone. And Mike, you mentioned the examples from other countries. I think it was the US and the Netherlands you used as examples of where surveys, diagnostic work, etc. had been done before targeted funds were deployed. I'd be keen if you could expand a little bit on that. What would the NASBET like to see here in terms of further study, further evidence gathering before we deploy additional funds?
Thanks, Ross. I mean, there is a tension here because you wonder, is it perhaps too late for that kind of work to be done, but we would argue it's not. That, you know, I think we still need a national steer on the questions to ask, if you like. So there's consistency in terms of the questions being asked, so that you can then, you know, rely on the data that you're getting and then better target who and where and what you need to target. I do think that's been missing, and certainly has been the case in other countries. But, you know, at the same time, it has been touched on earlier that, you know, there are kids out there who need help in all sorts of ways right now. And if we can identify that locally, and we have identified that locally, then let's try and give that help where we can. But I still think there's space for that more national direction in terms of a survey. And I also am heartened by the committee's desire to, if you like, follow the money, because I think we have had frustrations in the past around Scottish Attainment Challenge money and Pupil Equity Fund money in actually tracking how and where it's getting spent. And again, you know, there have been suggestions at the beginning, oh, well, we'll involve staff and trade unions and discussions, and then very often that hasn't happened. And so I'm heartened by that fact and would fully support that, although I do appreciate that perhaps brings an administrative burden, and maybe, you know, there's some help needed there as well.
Thanks very much. Yeah, the difficulties of tracking PEF money has been a long-running source of frustration in Parliament. Paragraph 11 of your written submission, Mike, mentions the need for ongoing system-wide evaluation if we're to actually be verifying whether or not recovery is happening. But I'm conscious that that could easily be done in a way that simply increases teacher workload, support staff workload, etc., in schools and at local authority level. What would an effective system of ongoing evaluation actually look like? I hesitate to use the phrase a light touch system, but you see what I mean, but a system that doesn't unnecessarily increase workload of those who are already overwhelmed.
Well, I think what you touch on there, Ross, is the need for much of that work to be done by people, you know, outside of the school, but in conjunction with the school. And again, you know, I have some sympathy with local authority colleagues who, you know, we might look to do a lot of that work because they're familiar with the schools, but they also have been overwhelmed with a great deal of work during the pandemic. But I think that's where that kind of work would need to be done. And again, with a steer nationally from government on what it is we're looking for, how we're going to collect that information, and then put it down to local level, to local authorities, to work with their schools. But as you say, there is always a danger in people being asked for more and more in terms of bureaucracy, and that taking them away, certainly at school level, from what they want to do, which is to do the best for the kids that are in front of them.
Thanks very much. And turning then to Jennifer and then Lauren on exactly the same question of effectively gathering data so that we can make targeted and then effective interventions. Could you maybe cite, are there examples of ongoing or planned work in this area? Because I think our committee are minded to recommend that further work is done here, but it would be useful for us to know if COSLA, ADES, etc. either have some ongoing work in this area or work planned in this area to identify just exactly what the impact has been. We've had a lot of discussions around, you know, the disproportionate impact on children with additional support needs, but that in and of itself is a vast category. That's more than one in every four young people, and from the discussions we've just had, it's had very different impact on children with autism compared to those with you know, visual impairment or hearing impairment, etc., etc. It would be useful to know if there is any work in this area that's already going on and will provide us with the kind of information that we're looking for.
Thank you. Yes, it's a good question, and I think that I suppose my initial reflection on that is that you know, research methodology is vast in and of itself, obviously, so we need to be very clear about, first of all, what questions are we asking, what's the how indeed did we arrive at the question that always informs research, and then what's the methodology. So there's been a few tools already mentioned today, obviously, but the design of your methodology, and I suppose I'm coming from a psychological perspective as a trained educational psychologist, but that should very much inform what we do. So so in terms of examples, and there was one, albeit it was embedded within the ADES report, so we undertook some small-scale research to determine what was happening with regard to attendance and engagement of young people during and as we were emerging, I suppose, into that first recovery period around attendance and engagement. And we worked with the Children and Young People's Improvement Collaborative, SIPIC, who facilitated across six authorities and a number of schools. And that used an improvement methodology, if you like. And so I think it was, you know, it's first of all, what's the question that you want to answer? And then what's the methodology that will best answer that question? So that's one example. I think there are other local authorities who may work locally with their universities, undertaking collaborative action research. Dundee City Council at the moment is undertaking collaborative action research across our schools in relation to the children who most concern us, who are the children who we think are most affected at the moment by a range of inequalities. But that's on a much larger scale. So I think there are different examples. I think we do need to do wider scoping around that. I suppose another area of work, albeit one that is being undertaken by ADES itself at the moment, which is in the early stages, which is taking a collaborative approach to improvement, where the research is of a collaborative inquiry approach in relation to a range of different themes, I suppose, which are emerging for local authorities. We'll be in a better position to report on that later next year, I would say. So I think it's a good question. I don't think it's a simple answer. And I think we need to, I think that focusing, I suppose, on what are some of the emerging things at the moment, we'd indicated some in the ADES report with regard to, for example, children, young people's speech and language needs at an early stage. And that may answer one of the earlier questions, excuse me, about early intervention. so being able to monitor now and going forward, actually, what impact early intervention approaches around children's speech and language will have as a means of recovery, as well as children's longer-term well-being would be one example. And similarly, I think some of the work, and Joan Trenent referred to some of it with regard to virtual learning. There are, again, small-scale examples across authorities where children and young people are being supported to continue in their virtual learning. And I suppose on a larger scale, the work that's taking place, for example, with eScoil, which is looking at how can we scale up virtual learning for those so that it's it becomes perhaps more of a universal experience without in any way taking away from the advantages of in-person learning. So I hope that's in some part answered your question.
Absolutely, that was very useful. Thank you. I'm conscious of time, but Laura, is there anything you'd like to add from a causal perspective on that?
Yeah, I'd like to highlight that there's the start of next year, I believe, the health and wellbeing census and the parental involvement engagement census. The results of that will be published. The research will be carried out start of next year and published towards the end of next year, I suppose. But also the health behaviour in school age children study with analysis of that will be published later in next year as well. And throughout the pandemic period, engagement of the Children's Parliament, Young Scot and Youth Link and Scottish Youth Parliament have been really important. They did some really good work around that, the lockdown lowdown report. Just in terms of evidence gathering and understanding children and young people's perspectives. So I think that your question was specifically around the evidence side of things, and that there is some work on the way and being undertaken to understand that so that we can move forward based on that.
Thank you. That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you, Ross Greer. Oliver Mundell. Oliver Link. Oliver Mundell. There he is.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I was just waiting to appear on the screen. I wanted to ask really about the situation in rural Scotland through the pandemic, and just whether the various witnesses had felt that we got the balance right. Even within my own constituency, there seemed to be a real mix. So in some of the larger towns and settlements, there was lots of support and contact between young people and their schools, but in more rural and remote communities, that wasn't always there. So I just wondered if that's something anyone wished to reflect on.
Anyone in particular?
I would wonder myself in terms of ADES and the kind of how high up the priority list that was for directors of education across the country.
Jennifer, that's over to you then.
Thank you for your question. I think rural communities as far as ADES were concerned. Absolutely as much a priority, because the children and young people who live in rural communities have as much entitlement and need for educational support as those who live in more urban communities. There would have been some more challenges with regard to in-person, I suppose, support or access to attending school for those who would have perhaps been eligible in terms of their need or vulnerability, because of transport, I would imagine, would be one barrier. But I think equally that some of the learning around virtual learning, for example, has in fact come from our rural and more communities. The Western Isles, for example, has led on areas around virtual learning for some time. So yes, ADES obviously represents 32 local authorities in Scotland, and the support for young people, children and young people in those communities has been a priority. There will have been, as I say, some perhaps geographic factors that have affected and have made accessibility, perhaps in-person accessibility, more challenging. But equally, as I said, there have been great lessons to learn from that as well.
Do you feel that we've got the resourcing balance right? I know it's hard for you. You know, you've been most familiar with Dundee, but do you think there is a recognition, you know, amongst those heads from 32 local authorities, that delivering education provision, whether it's during a pandemic or in normal times, you know, has different pressures and costs in rural communities?
Well, there will be some different pressures, I suppose. I mean, I've mentioned one, I suppose, because of the so schools that are, you know, geographically far spread apart, as they would be in Ireland or some other areas. There are different considerations, if you like, to a small urban authority such as the one I work in. And I couldn't speak to the detail of that, but I think ultimately, though, it's for the local authority and in consultation with their head teachers to make the right decisions and the best decisions and to monitor that as closely as possible. I'm sorry, that's probably the best that I can answer your question.
That's helpful, thank you. I think there's some others looking to come in, and I'll let you maybe direct them.
Yes, Mike Corbett, I think, is wanting to come in, Oliver. Mike?
Thanks, Convener. I would echo the point that Jennifer made about much of the excellent work around digital learning was really based on things that had already been going on previously in our rural communities. You know, Argyll and Bute and so on had done some excellent work in advance of the pandemic on that. Nevertheless, we had quite a bit of feedback that in terms of both hardware, software and connectivity, there continued to be and continue to be issues in some of our rural communities around digital learning. So that continues to be an issue with that kind of access. And also, you know, I don't want to go back to staffing again, but staffing of schools in rural areas remains a challenge. And particularly, you know, during the pandemic, when some staff have been off sick, it has been very, very difficult to get supply teachers in rural areas to support schools. So that has been another issue that has perhaps had an impact.
Thank you.
I think Joan Trenent wanted to come in as well, Oliver.
OK, thank you. I mean, mine isn't in relation to education per se, but I suppose just in relation to Social Work Scotland. Certainly holding meetings virtually meant that all 32 local authorities were present, and, you know, vulnerable children, which included talking about their education. That was a theme that we talked about every single week, because we held weekly meetings at that point during lockdown, etc. And whilst there were issues, as there were across the whole of Scotland, and connectivity, Mike just alluded to that, was one of them. You know, there was lots of support there in relation to, you know, what other means they could adopt in relation to making sure that vulnerable children were seen and their needs were being responded to. So from a Social Work Scotland perspective, it didn't feel that it was inequitable, I suppose, in relation to discussing their needs, etc., across that meeting. So it was very much a focus of certain meetings going forward.
Oliver, you want to continue?
I'm probably happy to leave it there. I mean, I think, okay. You know, obviously, the nature of the witnesses is they've not got direct experience of you know, more rural, yeah, local authorities. But I was keen, certainly, that issue was voiced. So I'll leave the question there, Convener.
Thank you, Oliver. Willie Rennie.
Thanks very much, Convener. This is about the Morgan Review and additional support for learning and needs. On a scale from kind of 1 to 10, how close are we to meeting the vision of the Morgan Review? And could I ask Jennifer about that first, please?
On a scale of 1 to 10, I would be hard to kind of quantify that. I think I looked again at the progress report in the last week, and I think that in spite of the pandemic, there's been a number of the recommendations that are on track. There are some that have been delayed or postponed, but I think that starting from the vision, for example, there's work being done with the inclusion ambassadors, and a vision has now been set and shared more widely. The work with GTCS Scotland in relation to the recommendations around teacher workforce and professional learning is underway. The recommendation in relation to pupil support assistance has been taken forward by the National Steering Group. The one which, and again, there has been some work done, which, and I think it's one of the most critical recommendations, which is the one related to outcome measures. That has, I think, now has to be taken and drawn into, if you like, or considered in relation to education reform, because that recommendation was really about looking at the visibility and the wider recognition of the outcomes that children and young people with additional support needs do achieve, but aren't always captured within the national performance framework. So while there's a strong need for that aspect of the ASL action plan to be progressed, it would be unwise to do that without taking it into consideration into the education reform. So I think good progress has been made. I think it's over five, if you had to pin me down between 5 and 10, but I think that in terms of the 9 broad areas of recommendation, if you refer to the action plan, progress has been made in relation to them.
I mean, my reading of the situation is that on the substance of it, you know, the position is quite stark. The numbers have been increasing in recent years. We're up at about a third, so it's a major proportion of the school population. Waits for diagnosis on a range of different needs is longer now. Support from the health service for mental health and so on, is the waits are incredibly long and getting longer. We've got the numbers of coordinated support plans has gone down in the past 8 years. The funding is challenging, and referrals to social work has been difficult as well. Is the system genuinely really coping?
I think the ASL review, Angela Morgan's review, was obviously written before, for example, some of the progress. I don't think it can be seen in isolation, is what I'm trying to say. I think it has to be seen alongside, for example, the mental health, children and young people's mental health and wellbeing programme board. So, for example, in relation to, you refer to waiting times for mental health support and diagnosis. Those areas have to be considered in relation to the work that the programme board is taking around neurodevelopmental service specification. I think there are 5 local authorities who are going to be undertaking pilots there, and that will inevitably support the shared approach, if you like, to assessment and intervention, so that while diagnosis is absolutely important and critical for some children and families, we shouldn't and they shouldn't have to wait for that diagnosis for support to be in place. And I think the neurodevelopmental service specification has standards which will very much support that. So I think that we have to look at the connectedness, if you like, between the different areas that that Angela Morgan's report allows us to do, if you like. It can't stand alone in isolation. And one of our recommendations indeed was about integrated policymaking across councils and their local partnerships. And that's, so we'd be wanting to see that integrated throughout a number of different areas and not just education, additional support for learning. And I think as far as the, and again, you mentioned coordinated support plans, and yes, the numbers are lower. I don't think that's a reflection of the plans and the planning that takes place for children, because, our data would suggest that there are still children with individual plans. They may not all be coordinated support plans. And I don't think it's necessarily a reflection of support not being available for children. However, what the CSP steering group or working group, which reported on, I think, just yesterday, It clearly has a number of recommendations around increasing awareness again of the legal basis, if you like, for coordinated support plan, as well as how it is integrated, if you like. I mean, we've spoken quite a bit today about bureaucracy, and it is important that the planning for coordinated support plans is integrated with other aspects of planning. And again, that's one of the recommendations from that report.
Okay.
I don't know if I've answered all aspects of your question.
That's fine. I mean, we heard from the EIS a couple of weeks ago, who were very concerned about the consequences of the inadequacies in the system and the effects, therefore, on teachers and what they had to cope with in the classroom. Are we providing enough support as we've moved towards mainstreaming in order for teachers to be able to cope? We know that the demand has increased through the pandemic. It's exacerbated existing issues and challenges. So are we giving enough support for teachers who are actually on the front line coping with this?
I think the support for teachers and indeed support staff, because they're obviously a large part of the workforce who support children with additional support needs, it has to be a continuing feature, if you like, of both schools and local authority workforce planning. You've rightly pointed out that we have about a third of children and young people identified with additional support needs, and therefore our approach to supporting teachers and their support staff has to be one that is much more universally based. If a third of children in some classrooms have additional support needs, and in some cases it may be more, then that has to be incorporated into, you know, classroom organisation, the accessibility of classrooms. We have to take that into account in long-term planning. I think NQT induction has to have additional support needs as a core feature.
Jennifer, could I stop you there? Sorry, Jennifer. I suppose my question is, are they getting enough support now? You've described what needs to happen in the structure, but are they getting support now? I'd like to bring Mike in after you've answered that. If you could answer that briefly, please, if that's possible. Are we getting enough support now for teachers?
I think that there's all more that we could do, but I think from my perspective and the ADES members that I represent, it's work that is continuous. It's a part of day-to-day experience of what we do.
So, Mike, what's your perspective?
Yeah, I would echo many of the concerns you've expressed there, and again, just point to pre-pandemic. And, you know, pre-pandemic, we were already saying that there was too much pressure regarding the mainstream agenda without enough support in schools, whether that's for nurture units or whatever it might be, that individualised or small group support that's often needed. So it was already an issue pre-pandemic. I think it's undoubtedly been made worse during the pandemic. The Morgan Review, I mean, I've got in my notes to always mention it whenever we mention the OECD review, because there is a fear we have that it's kind of been buried and half forgotten. So we do need to have those recommendations implemented. But at the moment, we would think there needs to be much more resource devoted to supporting additional support needs people.
So one final question to you then, Mike. On a scale of 1 to 10, where are we on the Morgan Review?
I mean, I don't want to give you a glib answer to that, but much, much more needs to be done, and there's not enough being done right.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Doesn't sound as if it's above 5. No. Mike O'Mara. 4. Did you say 4? A glib 4. Okay. Yeah. Mike O'Mara.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks to all colleagues for the evidence so far. I think the panel will be, I suppose, pleased to know, I think, that their evidence is chiming with the evidence we've had in recent weeks regarding the lack of overall analysis of need that's been undertaken in Scotland. And I think we've heard that loud and clear today, from not just in your answers to questions from colleagues, but also the written evidence. And it's in that context that I wanted to ask about changes to the Scottish Attainment Challenge. One of the has been touched on, one of the kind of the key sources of resource that Council's drawn for the provision. So last week, you'll be aware that the Scottish Attainment Challenge was reformed. That announcement detailed £35.5 million of year-on-year cuts to the funding, included £17 million from PEF, but it's also saw the reallocation of £43 million from the 9 most deprived authorities to spread it across 32 local authorities. Now, that means savage, eye-watering cuts to some of those local 9 original challenge authorities. So I want to ask across the panel, do you think these reforms would be beneficial or damaging to the recovery of education for the most deprived pupils in the most deprived communities in Scotland? And can maybe start by asking our colleague from COSLA, please.
Yeah, certainly. In terms of the Scottish Attainment Challenge announcement, we're working with Scottish Government closely in terms of next steps and how we work collaboratively through the Education Council and through local partnerships in terms of closing the attainment gap. And it's important that we avoid a top-down approach to setting the expectations and ambitions and avoid excess bureaucracy and reporting. But some of the key principles in terms of accountability are really important, ensuring that we've got system-wide delivery of recognising the specific contribution of education to reduce the impact of poverty, while at the same time recognising that the changes in the ways that we need to tackle poverty are not simply located within a school, and we need to make sure that through the work to develop and update the next Tackling Poverty plan, that we're taking a wider view of that and not simply looking at schools as being the answer to tackling some of those system-wide issues.
I'm not sure that's an answer to the question I asked, which was the impact on children, the most deprived children in the most deprived communities in Scotland, which are set to have significant cuts to their budgets as a result of the new agreed formula. Do you think it will improve outcomes or make it more challenging for local authorities and those 9 local authorities to cope?
I think that it's not a straightforward question. It's not a straightforward answer because we're not looking at we can't look at that in isolation to the wider perspective and how local authorities and their partners work to support children and families who are experiencing poverty and deprivation. So, yeah, that's one part of the picture, but we need to look at this in a holistic sense and make sure that we've got the adequate support from a range of services and that they're all adequately funded and that we're not just looking at one small part of it. Although I understand it isn't seen as a small part of it.
Okay, thank you.
That's part of the picture.
Okay, can I come to Jennifer King from Dundee City Council? I earlier declared an interest as an elected member of Dundee City Council. I'm aware from speaking to officers, Ms King, that we're looking at potentially upwards of £4 million of cut in Scottish Attainment Challenge funding to Dundee. What kind of adjustments are you looking at in the department to cope with that cut?
Thank you for your question. We're looking at that. I mean, we have the next few years, obviously, with the, I think we would use the word tapering of the funding, and the initial considerations we're giving are in relation to, as other authorities, I imagine, will be, because what the Attainment Challenge has allowed us to do is to test out, I suppose, and then build on interventions which have had an impact. We've done some work in Dundee, as you're probably aware, around with our nurseries around children's speech and language development. We're currently doing work with the Robert Owen Centre, and these have all been capacity building measures. So those are areas where they have had an impact, and we have built, I suppose, skills within the wider workforce, those would be the areas that we'd have to, you know, take into consideration with the forward planning. So there will be some challenging decisions to make. I think it would be unrealistic not to anticipate that, but we have to look at it in relation to where has there been learning that has enabled us to build that more widely. I suppose I would also follow on from the point that Laura made in that we have to look at it in connection with other sources of funding, if you like, that we don't know obviously the longer term around that. Much of the approach around community mental health and wellbeing, for example, is for children and families aged 5 to 25 in the case of care experienced young people. That's working more closely with our community providers who work and support with those in education. So I think it has to be looked at very widely, and I think the decisions that we have to take going forward have to be done in collaboration with our other partners in the local authority, and indeed with our colleagues and partners in NHS.
Appreciate my concern in terms of, as a native Dundonian, about what you're describing, the good work that has happened in recent years being under threat and having to be re-evaluated. Can we afford that at a time when need is increasing? Can I ask the other two panellists, in terms of this revision and the most areas of highest deprivation, what they think? That can we meet need when we're cutting resource in that way? Joan.
Okay, thank you. I'm a social worker to trade, so I'm not a an educationalist, although we're part of the Education Directorate, and I'm not one of the 9 local authorities that's that, you know, was a challenged local authority. Obviously, when budgets are cut, the impact will be felt across the board. But I think, as my colleagues have already alluded to, you know, this is multifaceted. So this is a time, probably more than ever, that we need to continue to pull together in relation to, you know, finding a solution to this. It's not what anybody wants to hear, but, you know, I think what we've evidenced through this pandemic is that collaborative working is at the fore of everything that we do. So hopefully we can continue that and find solutions that minimise any impact on families going forward. Thank you.
And a representative from the NASUWT.
Yeah, I mean, I understand the rationale to try and, you know, aid families and schools in areas outside the 9 local authorities where poverty has been identified. But to take the money away from those 9 authorities, the most deprived authorities, in order to do that will inevitably lead to, you know, some negative impact in those 9 authorities.
Thanks. If I can, Convener, I want to come on to a different issue, if that's OK. It relates to something I've asked a lot of questions about, which is ventilation, which may seem a little bit of a jump for some people in terms of the questioning, but in terms of our ensuring that we have continuous education in our schools, I think it's one of the very key issues, ensure that we've got that. I think our colleague from the NASUWT has made some has done some survey work or spoken to members. Can you maybe give us any kind of feedback in terms of what your understanding is in terms of the current situation relating to ventilation in schools and whether it's deemed to be adequate by your colleagues?
Yeah, well, obviously the commitment was made to purchase CO2 monitors across the country. We've had really patchy feedback on that. So I'll give you an example. We've got a local authority where they've not only installed CO2 monitors in every teaching area, they are linked to Wi-Fi and they are monitored constantly by local health and safety officers. And if there's a feeling that air quality is poor, they take immediate action. A number of other authorities, probably half, have bought mobile monitors, and so they're only in classrooms some of the time. There are also issues about the installation of some of those monitors, you know, some being too near windows, etc. So there's a real issue about the quality of the data that some local authorities are gathering. And obviously, you know, at the moment, another new variant, you know, our members are more anxious than ever that there should be good ventilation and good air quality in their classrooms, and certainly in some areas, we don't think we can see that.
So, and the commitment from the Scottish Government was that would be in 100% of classrooms. Has that happened?
Well, that wouldn't be our... we were told there is access to a monitor in 100% of classrooms, but if that is a mobile monitor that is only in your classroom or your teaching area briefly and then taken round the school, I don't see how that can give us reasonable data to then act upon.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Kimbiel.
Thank you. And I turn now to James Dornan, who I think will probably be our final questioner.
Thank you, convener. I wasn't going to come in at this stage, but just a bother to Michael Mara's points. Can we not clarify here that there's X amount of money to go about? There's not just poverty in cities such as Glasgow and Dundee, that there's poverty in council areas and in cities, constituencies right across the country. And it's only right that we target those who need it, not based on their geographical area, but based on their need. And is it not also true that the Causal themselves, the Labour and Clyde Council leader, Stephen McCabe, who's the Causal spokesperson, Children and Young People, welcomed this new funding allocation? It seems fairer. Michael quite rightly defends his constituents, but he's got the chamber to do that. Here we are meant to be looking at the best for children across the country, not simply in the constituencies or the city that we represent.
I think that was perhaps more of a rhetorical contribution than a question. So I think, Michael, you've made your feelings clear on that. I would like to thank Jennifer King, Laura Cavan, Mike Corbett and Joan Trenent, who have been our witnesses this morning. Thank you for giving us of your time and presenting us with your evidence and being so willing to say your piece, which is what we depend on. So the public part of today's meeting is now at an end. I will now suspend the meeting. Can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, which will allow us to consider our final agenda items in private. Thank you again, and good morning.